understand that. And we'll be in prayer. Let's go before the Lord even now. Father God, we thank you for tonight. So grateful for your goodness and mercy and how you have provided for us, Lord, through the years. Not just today, but you have a good track record of blessing us, keeping us, and blessing us again. And we're thankful for that type of favor. Lord, you oversee us. You watch over us. You care for us. You tenderly provide for us. And we just pause to say thank you. Nothing wrong with thank you. We can't do anything much, but we say thank you to acknowledge you as God, Lord, Savior, and Lord of this world, and also Lord of the next. Bless us now in this study. Keep us with your keeping. In Jesus' name. Amen. I want to say how much I am glad to study tonight the favor of God. And the favor of God to me is so awesome, we have to pause sometimes to think about it. And that definitely sounds like thunder. They showed that baseball team with that clap of thunder and those men jumping like children. As if thunder come close enough, it's louder than anything you can hear. So I jumped a minute ago because that'll make me jump. But I want to tell you, share with you before we get started. I've been studying and trying to study Einstein's theory of relativity. Now, I know that has nothing to do with the Bible study, but whatever Einstein learned, God put in. Yeah. Is that right?
Yeah.
And his theory of relativity is that time and space are almost united. And time and space is the way God made the universe, and it has a fabric, and all of that. But I was fascinated to see his theory of relativity. He had it in a little movie, so you don't have to have all that smarts to try to follow it. But if you just follow the movie, it'll teach you what that involved. But Einstein had to have several to prove his, that time can be bent, and that we're in almost, like you said, a little context, a parenthesis of time. And that if you go far enough in space, at the speed of light, you can alter time. And that's fascinating, because you can outrun time. Maybe that's the best way to say it. If you go fast enough, you can outrun time. And well, it doesn't seem possible, but he says this is the way we'll explain it. God gave him a great mind. And they tested his theory because they needed to do an eclipse of the sun. There needed to be an eclipse of the sun to test the relativity theory. They went all over the world. Finally, they found a blind when the moon was eclipsing the sun, and the sun had a solar eclipse, and they tested it, and they said it was 100% right from what he knew about time. It blew our the world's concept of time, because we said we're in past, present, and future. He said, but if you go far enough and fast enough, at the speed of light, which is, I told you, about 186,000 miles per second, we don't have anything that can go that fast. So if we ran, we still wouldn't outrun time. But the truth of the matter, light and space can do that. My question was, he must have seen God in an awesome way to be able to think, sit down and think. He was a clerk in a patent office in Switzerland. But yet he was a physicist who had studied, and he was an average, mediocre student, Sister Robert. At the time, in fact, he was so average, they told him, you're not going to get a job in academia, you better go out on the street and get you a job. That's all right. But when God got through blessing him with favor, the world had to stand up and applaud him for all the things he did. So that brings me into the subject tonight of favor. When God gives you favor, the world can't stop it. When God gives you something, the door cannot be shut if God opens it. And it can't be opened if God closes it. So we want to talk about favor tonight. Einstein is a great example of when God gives you a brilliant mind. We all weren't blessed with a brilliant mind, but this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Everybody can't be an Einstein. The world couldn't stand that many. Amen. Because so many things would be discovered and blow us out, blow out. But the fact that you get out, time travel is he said it's possible. So I got to look at that. I'm fascinated by science. I'm fascinated by the fact that God put signs here that man didn't. Amen?
Amen.
All man got to do is let God tell him. And if he lets God tell him, he'll get some understanding. So I don't want to take you too far on that. It was just on YouTube. It was a great subject. It was a great treatment of it. And I'm fascinated by it enough to want to study it. And even E equals MC squared, all that stuff, energy equals mass times space times the speed of light squared. And that's all I know. I've really showing out all I know right here. Hallelujah! Because I wasn't a great student in science either. But I'll tell you one thing, since I know Jesus, I tell you the world opens up. When I learned that what Jesus could do, I said, boy, there's nothing he cannot do. And he can do anything but fail. He walked among us the dusty roads, he healed the sick and raised the dead. What kind of people had a response to that? A dead man getting up. And today they would be showing that over and over on the endless loop on CNN, Sister Robin. And here he is getting up again. They'd be just showing it over and over, just like they did the bombers on 9/11. We'd be sick of it after a while, Sister, because we'd have seen it 150 times. But what we do, we believe the word.
Yes.
And I thank God he came in the era that he did, because the news media would make you sit here and buy.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
But now he came in a time when there was no news media, there was no camera, no photography. All it was you got to believe. Yes. And that's where God is today. I want to talk just for a little while about this wonderful favor God did for the Egyptians and how God's favor still resonates throughout the universe. And when God is ready, he says, I'm God, I will have mercy on whom I'll have mercy on.
Yeah.
And I'm God. And that's not for anybody else to question. And so when you get your blessing, you don't have to explain it to anybody.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Folk want to know this and that.
Yeah.
When God blesses you, he blessed you.
Yeah.
He didn't bless them. Amen?
Amen.
And that sounds a little selfish. I'm coming to Reverend Elder Langston's song. I came to church for my blessing and I got mine. Well, if God gives you your blessing, then you are blessed.
Yeah.
And you don't have to apologize for being blessed.
Amen.
Isn't that a good thing?
Amen.
And we're going to look tonight when God blesses you, and God knows how to bless you, as the saying goes, real good. He knows how to bless you better than you could think of blessing yourself. And because it's just that, it's God's mercy coming from heaven down into your life and supplying all your needs according to his what? Riches in glory. So God can do that. I'm going to show that tonight, because in the case of the children of Israel in bondage for 430 years, they were in bondage. And God says, I'm going to bring you out one day. One day I'm going to bring, in fact, the self same day you went in, I'm going to bring you out that day. I will time it to the day. Nobody else will know it, because those who went in, Joseph and his brethren, and the 70 who came into Egypt and became a great multitude of the Israelite nation, he said, I'm going to bring you out the same day they went in. I'm going to bring you the same, that day is going to be the same day you come out. Isn't God exact? And God, a thousand years with the Lord is this what?
One day.
So there's that measurement of time again. Einstein was right. Uh-huh. God, one day, when we go through 1,000 years, God said, oh, that was just 2 minutes on my clock. That wasn't even 2 minutes, because I'm in eternity. So it really wasn't time at all. So God says, so here's this thing. God takes them into bondage with Jacob and his brothers. Jacob and his sons go into Egypt for the famine. And Joseph, of course, is prime minister. And Joseph takes care of his dad, and the Egyptians did not like to fool with cattle, so they made Joseph's brothers herdsmen in Goshen. And all the herd was kept in Goshen, because the Egypt didn't want to smell that stuff. Y'all get out in Seguin or somewhere on Sweet Home back in there, and y'all stay there. That's basically what they were saying. Don't come out, just tell us what the monies are and all that. So Joseph and his brothers had favor with Pharaoh. But then there arose, after Joseph died, a Pharaoh that knew not Joseph. And therefore he enslaved them, and when they went into slavery, they were there 430 years. Almost equivalent to the story of America when the first slaves came here at at the Plymouth Rock. The first day it came at Plymouth Rock, and then from that point on, it was thought of get the dark people to do the heavy labor because they can do it and they're subhuman anyway. But we were put into slavery, you can count almost 300 years at least. If you go and look at it differently in terms of segregation, it could be 400, maybe 500. Some of us still in slavery. But that's economic slavery. But the whole idea, we were in slavery about 300 years. So here is God saying, there'll be a day when you'll come out. And when you come out, I'm going to bless you. And when I bless you, it will be my blessing to you. So that is the way God spoke to Israel. Let's go to the book of Exodus. And let's get to chapter 12. And we get to chapter 12. We want to look at the last of the plagues, which is the death of the firstborn. It took the 10 plagues to get to 12 and 29. Exodus 12 and 29, it took 10 plagues to get there before people, the Egyptians, were ready to allow the Israelites to go. What will it take? It would take the death of their firstborn. What would it take? Somebody dying whom they loved a lot and they were helpless to do anything about it. And so it took that kind of shock to get them to let the children of Israel go. But it also, God had promised them, when you go out, you're not going empty-handed. Amen? Amen. I'm going to give you some of their treasures and gold of Egypt, and I'm going to do that for you. Why? Because I'm God. So here we go. God not only got them freedom, he gave them money. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all can say, don't shout me down, preach the truth. All right, it says in verse 29, it came to pass, this is the death of the firstborn. This is the Passover of the death angel. It came to pass that at midnight, the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. From the firstborn of Pharaoh, that set the precedent, that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of Canaan. That's in Exodus 12 and 29. Verse 30 says, and Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one being. Do you suppose God was serious?
Yes.
How would you have liked to have lived that one night just to see how it was like? The death angel moving through. I know Cecil B. DeMille showed it as a green mist coming through the streets, and Moses was telling Joshua, come in and close the door. We don't want to see the death angel pass. But the death angel went to every house and smote. And instantaneously, you might say. How did the angel do it? He did it quickly.
Yeah.
Angels are swift messengers, and they weren't locked in the time sequence we are. Amen? They moved in a different time sequence, heavenly time. He smote the firstborn of every man, woman, child, in terms of if it was their firstborn, and then he went to the cattle and dealt with that. Now, what kind of news would that give Pharaoh? How can you fight who you don't see? We are whooped before we get out of the saddle, before we get on the saddle. Amen?
Amen.
And so this was a shock. This would be a great shock, and that was a great cry. Not only are you whooped, but you gotta now mourn the firstborn who was living a minute ago and is dead. You got to go into mourning. So this was a bad night all around. If you were Egyptian, it was a great night if you were a Hebrew. Why was it a great night? Because God, you would have put blood over your doorpost and the death angel would have passed by. And therein is the Passover, would have passed over your house. All right?
Yes.
Now let's go further down, because that's not all. It's enough that you're alive. Let me jump back to something, current event. And the tornado that hit Oklahoma, the world's largest tornado on record, in the history of watching and keeping record on. How would you feel to have come through that? I mean, you hear this sound, and the tornado always sounds like a big train. Everybody hears the same. If you're sitting there standing at a railroad track, you can hear those things, boom, 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 boom. It's not going whoa, whoa, it's going boom, 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 like those box cars going over the rail track. Those people heard those things, went into their little basement, and went in there, stayed in there, And it take long, but it took long. It seemed like an eternity when that thing is trying to suck the air out. And then all those people, of course, who lost their home, black man said, I went in there and came up and came, thinking something was wrong when I saw the sky and didn't see my ceiling. And he said, oh, I've been hit. When something, but he was alive. You miss your house, and we would all miss our house, and we would ever be forever marked in our life by everything we loved that the tornado took. But we would always be thankful. Yes, you would, for your life. Yeah. So that morning, that night when Pharaoh was up and all the crying was over, was happening, the people who were Hebrews were saying, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, dear God. They had to thank God. Because you didn't touch here's my firstborn. And they could go all, and they could all see, and God put a distinction between the Egyptians and the Israelites. Now, the next thing he would do is give them some money. Amen?
Amen.
After you get your life, and they say, you're happy for your life, when I'm going to get paid? You want some money. Amen? Y'all say amen. Don't be quiet.
Amen.
All right. So he says here now, and Pharaoh was, and he called Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up and get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord, as you have said. He didn't say that easy. He was mad. Get on out of here. Is that what he said? Also, take your flocks. All right? Get your flocks. Get your nasty, stinky cows and get on out of here. That's basically what he was saying in our vernacular today. We understand that. We say, who get my cow? Let me go. And he says, now, and your herds, and he said, and be gone, and bless me also. In other words, your presence, your absence will bless me. All right? He sounds pretty good. Sounds like the meanest boss you ever had. And the Egyptians were urgent upon the people that they might send them out of the land in haste. But they said, we all be dead men. Look at what that God has done. I ain't playing with that God. You know, we almost need some of that old-time religion right now. When God comes through here and say, oh, people say, I ain't playing with God. I am God. We either going to serve him or we getting out of here.
Right? Yeah.
Amen. And the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneeling troughs, and being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders. And the children of Israel did according to the word of Moses. And they, watch this, borrowed of the Egyptians jewels of silver and jewels of gold and raiment. All right? The people was, you go, and they start taking off their jewelry. Good custom-made jewelry, all diamonds and pearls and emeralds and everything that was expensive. They just say, here, go, we want peace. And you know, when you're ready for somebody to go, you thought, what's it going to take? I'll take off my ring. Give it to them, huh?
Amen.
They had a sense of urgency that God put in them. But what was God doing with the people? Verse 36 tells us, the whole key is in 36. And the Lord gave the people what? Favor in the sight of whom? So that they lent unto them such things as they required. And here's the sum total. And they spoiled the Egyptians. That's Exodus 12 and 20:36. They spoiled, which means this was God's way of saying, I'm going to pay you for 430 years of being a slave. You didn't get paid, you didn't get no sick leave, you didn't get no annual leave, you didn't get a retirement, but you're going to get some gold tonight. Amen? They were ready for that. When God gives you favor, song that Norman Hutchins writes, it's your season to be blessed. God promised you stood the test. But when God is ready for your season of blessing, and that is a season of blessing, you go to the book of Psalms, and Psalm says, but he that, of course, would keep his mind stayed on the Lord, meditates in his word day and night, and he shall be like a tree planted by what? The rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his, hello, season. And his fruit also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. God has a season of prosperity, a season of blessing. I don't care how long it takes, it's coming. Amen. And when it comes, it will fulfill the promise of God. This is a key verse, 36. The Lord gave the people favor. When God gives you favor in somebody's eyes, it's not because you're so pretty. It's not because you're so handsome. It's not because you're so smart. Huh? It's because God has turned a heart and he's given his favor to you upon the heart of that person. And people can't understand it. But if they don't understand it and they're not part of it, don't worry about it. Take the blessing and don't try to give a lesson. Amen.
Amen.
Just take the blessing and move on. The other person will get their lesson by and by. Amen.
Amen.
But God gave them favor and they spoiled the Egyptians. Alright, now let me get to another part here. I like that part because God was blessing and God was in control. If we get to the Red Sea and they're trapped in, and they're trapped in the little cul-de-sac, God tells them, stand still and see the salvation of God. These Egyptians that you see today, you will see again no more forever. God is always in the business. When you put him in the equation, he's in the blessing business, he's in the protecting business, he's in the favor, and he is in God being preserving you as you walk even through the valley of the shadow of death. God is with you there. He is just a God of multiplicity. He's a God of diversity. And when he says he's going to bless you, he has a way of blessing. They couldn't bless themselves. We are arguing today as a race of people. Where's our reparation? Where's our 40 acres in a mule? They're going to never give it to us. When they put the Asians and Japanese in concentration camps, that was reparations at the end of that. They shouldn't have been paid for that. Jews, of course, argued when their labor was used to build the great factories in Germany, those factories should be giving reparations to the Jews' great-great-grandchildren because they took their knowledge and they took their labor and they got reparations. What do you say, Mr. Listen? When it's our turn to get ours, we don't get it. We don't get it from men, but we serve the God of heaven.
Right.
And he gives us in another way things that we would do. Amen?
Amen.
And there is a season of blessing. And when God gives favor on your life, again, it's not because we've merited it, but it's because God says in his word, I will give you all favor, Hebrews, in the eyes of your enemies. And when I get through whipping them and whipping them and whipping them, they'll be happy for you to go and they'll give you everything they wearing, everything they got on, everything they got stored, just so you can get out of their sight. Have anybody ever given you some money and just said, just take it? Huh? Somebody said, just take it. If it's part making, I said, take the money. Have you ever done that? Or somebody ever did that to you? Y'all haven't lived yet. Huh? You took that money, didn't you? Somebody said, take it. Oh, take it. And now we go take it. Some folks can get fed up with whining. Huh? Like the lady I did over at IHOP on Walsham Road. She was hollering all morning that the bus boy took her $5. I couldn't eat it when she jumped down. I didn't know it. And she was just loud. And you know, if you have a good manager, they cut that stuff down. They tell her, be quiet. You're disturbing the customer. That was no manager. She just went on.
Wow.
And finally I said, what is so appalling about what happened? And they told me, well, she claimed the bus boy took a $5. I told you all this story. And I said, well, how much was it? $5. I said, tell her, take this $5. I said, be quiet. Be quiet. Let folks eat their food. And just be quiet. And whatever he took, here's $5. And I'm going to pray for her in church. I think when my waiter got to tell him to the story to him, he said, that man over there said, here's your $5, shut up. That's what it is. And she shut up for a while. Amen. It was $5 worth the look on her face when she walked out and saw a black man told her, shut up. that was worth the price of admission. Everybody can't do that. I was led that morning to do that because I had enough and my cup was full. But there are those moments in time, like these Egyptians, when God says, I'm going to touch their heart and I'm going to bless you through them, even though they've been your enemy and your nemesis, I'm going to use them to bless you. They're going to be so glad to see you go, they're going to give you everything. And the Bible says they spoil. Spoil means like you went to war and defeated the enemy and you take everything. But no, God had the enemy, in this case, give them. Didn't God something? When the Lord is ready for something, he'll give it to you. You don't have to steal it.
Right.
People steal stuff and connive and get into cahoots and do everything to try to get them. God don't need your help.
Right.
He's God. If he wasn't God, When God is ready to bless you, he knows your address, your phone number, your email, even though your text account. God can bless you any way he wants to bless you. And if you have the favor of God, nothing can stop your blessing. And let me tell you something else. When you get your blessing, don't feel sorry for anybody else and give your blessing away. I just said something powerful. Because sometimes when you got a blessing and somebody else do it, I wish I had, you know our folks. Come on, come on. I wish I had that. I was thinking about that. Don't give your blessing to them. If God would have wanted them to have it, come on. He would have given. I'm sure preaching this. You ain't gonna hear this on TV in now. They're gonna tell you how to get a blessing. They're gonna tell you, don't share it. But when God gives you your blessing, you hope for yourself. He meant it for you.
Praise God.
He knew it was for you. And don't you go sharing when you don't have to. Because he meant it for you. Now you give God what he's due. I ain't saying no time. I'm saying don't give it away to somebody who's looking pitiful and all they want to do is play with it and throw it away. As Grandmama said, eat it up in a day. Throw it to the wind. Amen.
Amen.
Hold your blessing and see what God wants you to do with that blessing for you. Because what God has for you, the song says, is for you. Amen?
Amen.
So this is a good lesson. So the Egyptians went out that day, the Israelites went out that day, and the Egyptians gave them everything, and they never came back. They said, here, borrow this, borrow that. They wanted an assumption it was borrowed. Huh? Borrow this. Yeah, you can have this. Bring it back. Yeah. Took it. Let me get some more for you. And they never intended to come back, and the Lord never intended for them to come back.
Wow.
And somebody said, well, I feel bad about it. No, you don't. If God gave it to you. Amen?
Amen.
Some of y'all got 10 godly conscience. If God, y'all wouldn't have done well with this type of blessing. Because you would have said, Miss Ann would have said, here my jewels. Now you take good care of them, you hear? Huh? And we'd have been, yeah, you bring them back to me just like you found it. Take those things and say, I'm never coming back. And they knew they weren't coming back. And when they got to where they were going and didn't go back to Miss Ann, it wasn't their problem. Amen. God says, I'm going to bless you. But this is what your foreparents worked for 430 years. And I want you to have it. You will not go empty-handed. When Jesus was born, and the wise men brought to him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Is that right?
Right.
He was at least 2 years old, and he was in a house when they did that, not in a stable. Okay. But soon as they brought the gold, Joseph and Mary had to flee because the edict was going to be every male child that's in Bethlehem would be destroyed. And if God hadn't moved them from Bethlehem and gone into Egypt, the Christ child would have been killed. So what did the wise men do? They brought a means of money for Joseph and Mary to get out of town.
Yeah.
Amen? And when they got out of town to live over in Egypt long enough till the boy got some size and come back. God knows what he's doing when he blesses you. Don't blow all your money in one way.
Yeah.
Is that a good lesson?
Amen.
All right, I'm through with that. Amen. Let's stand. That's our lesson. God give you that lesson. Don't give it to everybody. Amen. My pastor told me. Y'all wasn't going to give it to him anyway, but now you got a good reason not to. Amen. My pastor told me don't share my blessing. All right. God bless you. We're going to